is Victor Mazón Gardoqui, and we are coming under this project called RO, the platform RO, and we have been doing here this seminar speculation as an interface.
Yeah, my name is Mario de Vega, so I work with Victor for some years already.
And is it your first time working with sonic acts, or it's not the first time you're here?
No, we worked before, so that's why we already met. So it's 2015. We were here and we keep, let's say, working together with sonic acts in a way.
The relations.
Yeah.
Can you just tell a bit more about the workshop we are here now? What the workshop is about and who is participating in that workshop?
So we have 11 participants coming from different backgrounds, different disciplines, also different generations, which I think is quite interesting. And we divide the workshop in 3 days. And the first day is basically a presentation for them, with them, and from us. And the second day, we are building up a receiver, a portable device that basically is able to translate frequencies produced by mobile telecommunication devices into sound. And today is mainly a discussion about what they experience with the device, what they discover with the device. And this is more or less what you could hear when you were here.
Do you think there are any particular results which will be gained after the workshop?
Well, the best result would be first meet all these new people and all these conversations, all the talks that we have been doing, this similar setup of workshops, seminars in different universities or in different festivals. And the interesting part of it in this not just wonderful space, but also like the participants, they come from different disciplines with different interests, and then it's when we can start to open like a communication or like a discussion about these topics, that about this invisibility, this high frequency, this pollution, this dissemination of information, and present the platforms and the projects we have been doing for these past 10 years, condensed on these 3 days of talks, eating together, going out afterwards. So it's like a great connection.
And what about the devices your participants are working on? What are they for, the devices?
Well, as Victor said, we work together for 10 years already, and we have been working on different interfaces. What we brought today is, let's say, one portable device that will first, I would say, listen to certain frequencies that are beyond human cognition. So, I mean, we are not able to perceive those frequencies, but they are here surrounding us or inside us everywhere. And this tool is basically paying attention to these frequency ranges, listening to them and scaling down into an audible range or human audible range. So basically what you perceive is all these invisible fields produced by artificial electromagnetic activity produced by humans. So in a form of mobile phones, Bluetooth data exchange, microwaves, radar technologies in general. And yeah, basically it's a tool that reveals this information with the use of sound.
And have you experienced any, how to say, not attacks, but any critiques? Maybe from the government or from the other people who thinks that you're like uncovering the hidden information.
Yeah, that's interesting, because we have been working, let's say, from other projects that they also come, as Mario said, like from all this research. We were like working with other devices that they were more in this threshold of legality, like creating transmitters instead of something that listens, because in this case it listens and exposes this information, as you said. But then when you create a transmitter, you start to transmit on a specific frequency. So then you can choose like an FM band then you can choose like a black and white video. So it's in that ranges where the more problems might come from a government or from this security and control. In this case, it's more this idea of awareness. So then you just expose this, but as awareness of what has the impact of all this human-made radio, as Mario said, in this range, or if this specific narrow band spectrum for the telecommunication systems. So then through this device, you can learn how to build it, you can learn how to use it, but at the same time, the discussion of what's the impact of these frequencies, of what's the impact of this pollution, is what address some much, much more interesting talks and discussions.
And you told that you started working already for 10 years, you are working for 10 years already with this subject, with this theme. And how do you think, how is the world information area has been changed through these 10 years? Do you think it becomes like more difficult to get it, or it, the electromagnetic, if I may say so, field become a very much high now? How does it change within these 10 years?
Well, it's complex because, I mean, basically we are surrounded by technologies for isolation. So, I mean, let's say we are dependent on mediums to communicate, to interact with the world. So, I mean, and we demand the fastest connection, and we demand instant communication, and we demand the newest technologies, and we are all immersed in this. So, in a way, I think you could say people probably are more aware of certain privacy issues, like what we were discussing today. But the reality is that we are not really able to go away from this. So it's a codependent relation. So as we basically are, yes, like completely suppressed by these technologies. And what we are trying is not to say those technologies are bad. So I mean, it's basically how you use these technologies. I mean, how you approach them. So I mean, let's say in artistic field, so how can you really consciously use technology? So I mean, it's of course, in most of cases you will have a fascination for the medium or the tool in terms of interface or electronic interface, but what are, let's say, all what is behind this? So I mean, what are the consequences of using technologies and how you approach technologies? And this is basically what we are trying to do with them, so to open a discussion or a conversation about those things, using those tools as an excuse in a way. So let's say, yes, as Victor said, you build up something. It's a challenge also to build it because it's small and it's fragile and it has certain things. But that's the starting point to have these conversations.
And speaking about the instruments and the tools, what is that actually, Victor? Probably, can you tell?
Yeah, basically, what we were doing, like in the workshop, was this device called Limenia. So Limenia comes from Limen, that is the minimum amount of information that our in psychology, like from our brain, to detect, like to feel. Let's say when you feel heat, when you touch something, when you smell something. So this threshold of when you receive it or not. And through the antenna, that basically is based from this antenna to the print other antenna, receives this electromagnetic pollution in the high range, in the high frequency range and microwaves, and then amplifies to have a decibel scale. So basically the input to the output comes from electromagnetic frequency and comes the voltage for be amplified by a PA or by headphones. So the of course we are in sonic acts here in this festival. The output is sonic. Let's say we there is the audio output, but there is two pins that also you can use it for measurement to analyze. So two pins with a microcontroller you connect to analog to digital pin, and then you can measure this thing or pass through a spectrogram. So there is like one part that first address this and receive this information, but there is the other part where you can use it for a composition, where you can use it for speculate in other terms, to measure with the device, and then to experience all this high frequency pollution that normally we are not aware of them. At the same time, like the research start, like this is version 6 already maybe from the unit, but we were like compiling like a series of works in a book that also we were contacting like different authors to write from the perspective of a philosopher or a scientist or a curator to discuss also about these topics that is very like an expanded version of what we have been doing these 3 days here, where also the cover of the book offers you to listen, because it acts as an antenna, to listen to this high frequency. So it's how to make a compendium of information, of research, of text from different points of view, not just only through our eyes.
Yeah, as Victor said, let's say those kind of things involve a wider community, so it's not just we together deciding certain things, but it's also bringing people to contribute and to discuss about certain things. And that's why we basically truly believe in the power of a publication. So it's an object that remains and that it occupies space in a way. And we are trying to, let's say, it's not just the fact of printing books. So I think there are enough beautiful books in this world, so and we are trying just, let's say, to produce objects that vibrate and that resonate in space. So when you have, let's say, in this case, a publication that becomes an antenna or a receiver, then you have the possibility to offer other kind of information. So you have a different access to certain things. So it becomes, in a way, more didactical. So, I mean, you can understand or approach certain things easier, probably. And at the same time, you involve a different community. So you involve more people that contribute. And that's the starting point of everything, so to put content together.
Also the importance, like when you have the book, you have all the text, you get this information, so you just read and by through cognition you understand all this information, but it's so direct when you just put the headphones, you just connect the power and then you just feel it. So when you just get this moment of the experience of it, everything is much more easy to understand and to feel that, to trigger the rest of the discoveries that you will get doing through reading, through accessing to different networks to get to extract this information.
Do you think it can be, I think it's my last question, do you think it can be an approach in learning the materials? Because this year Sonic Act's theme is again studying and maybe finding another approaches in the learning procedure in the art schools, in the art colleges. And are there any crises right now in the art colleges with the approaches they have as a classical one? And can this kind of approaches be a new way of learning things?
Well, I would say it's clear there is a crisis in education. So, I mean, that's something that, let's say, with a critical view, we can all agree. So the thing here is, what are the possibilities then? So what are these other methods to approach knowledge exchange? So, I mean, how can you transmit information and who will receive this information? For this, you first need to build up community, people who are interested in this. And then with the interest of people, so then you can give these contents. But in a way, this is why we start to work closer to with Sonic Acts, because we are basically trying to do this. So, I mean, let's say, as we said, in the form of publications or this thing with, we were showing you before, that it's a platform. It's a platform to provide content. So let's say, in a very simple way, is you can imagine this as a small portable server that will allow you to display information digitally. So you can store certain information into the memory of the system, but the system itself provides the light to access the printed content of the object. At the same time, the system is a microcontroller, so you can use this for pedagogical purposes. So you can, let's say, work together with the students with physical computing, so you can use the internet as a platform for education, so you can contribute with information in form of text, for example. And that's, let's say, one little giving, let's say, to say, okay, there's something to do.
Also, there is like one part, like from education, that you can see is like clearly, like I'm from the academy, from the universities, but nowadays it has spanned, or in the last 20 years has spanned, how you access to the information through all these virtual platforms. So we used to have our website as a platform where we put there all the content, where there are the schematics, like, but also the information, the text, how to recreate, because we are not selling, let's say, these devices, these tools for the seminars, so then you can access to the knowledge, to the open hardware design. So there is these non-regulated ways of learning that now also festivals are starting to push, let's say, from the last, I could say, like, in America, like around 8 years, like many festivals, they started more, let's say, where the artist could make an artist talk. Then it was also having some practical things, how to use like a software, how to use a tool. And I think it's getting much more sophisticated. It's allowing also more time. So it's not a 4 hours workshop, it's not a 3 hours talk where you're just in front of the people. They can start to offer, like as we are here during 3 days, like from 9 in the morning till 6:30, while we after stay like another 2 hours with them down, having some beers and talking, and much more informal. And this, I think, is also twist this idea of how to access to knowledge and how also these platforms start to create other values. That for us is one of the main tasks to get learning and digging into these concepts.
Yeah, in a way, I think it's a contribution of love. It's basically promoting this. So as you love what you do, and you wish that people love what they do. So let's say that basically it's this need to exchange opinions of what love means.